thumbs up. I'm starting. I'm Will Woods. This is Scriptlet Forum and RPM Independence, Building Images in the Container Era, which is kind of a mouthful that I've been living with an academic for the past few years, and academic use has crept into my brain.
Well, can you be a lot more loud?
Huh?
Can you be more loud?
Oh, I certainly can.
Awesome.
There we go. All right, so who's this guy? I'm Will Woods. I do stuff. I've done a whole bunch of things. Most of my career has been dealing with getting images sort of, or getting systems installed and booted. So like, once the system's actually running, I get bored. But all of our things that build images or do installs and things like that are things I have worked on. I'm also the person who said the phrase "beat view miracle," so sorry about that, or you're welcome. I don't know. So the main sort of thing that I want to talk about here as like background is, where do images come from? Because we have a whole lot of terminology and ideas around how all of this process works, and the last time we had a big talk about these things, I ended up, anytime anyone mentioned anything like a module or a component or a group, I would write it down on a post-it so we could try and figure out how these things interrelated, and I ended up with a stack of post-its like 40 high, and we never figured it out. So instead, I'm going to tell you how it works. And really what it works like is this, and it's pretty easy. They're out in the world, so ignoring the way, you know, just talking in the abstract, out in the world there are upstream projects, and they release sources, you know, they do source releases. We take those, and we take a individual source release, and build configuration, which is like, you know, spec file, instructions about how to build things, also all other, like, build settings and stuff like that. Put that into a build environment, or the image build part there, and we do a build. And you end up, so you put those things together and you get binaries, you get a build. And you want to make an image, well, you take a recipe and a whole heap of builds, and you do some depth solving, and you mash it all together, and you end up with an image. This is a really oversimplified version, but that's basically how it works. And it's sort of important to make sure everybody's thinking about these things in the same way. And one of the important things is that it is a loop. You need a build environment in order to make builds, but you need the builds to make the build environment. So it's a thing to keep in mind. You can get real mathy with it, and we kind of want to, because one of the problems that we have is that when you're doing mathy stuff, like, you don't have side effects. You add two and two, you don't get like four, but also a lizard is in your house now. You just get four. So like, we want to make our processes work a lot more like math and avoid side effects whenever we can. All right, so three comes in the middle there, but we'll come back to that. Take your time. But yeah, so this is, I mean, roughly this is what we're talking about here, but there's one part at the bottom, right? Like, you can kind of follow along. You got a project, and it needs a bunch of sources, and then you do the source and the build environment, build config, and you get builds, and a build is like build artifacts and metadata. And a recipe, well, okay, so you have a recipe, which is just the user wants a few things, and we can use that metadata and turn it into a manifest, or like a list of the actual builds that would satisfy the recipe. Once you have that list of builds, in theory, if the world was easy, you could just take all of the contents of all of those builds, smack them into some sort of container, and be done. But that doesn't work. We need some sort of magic. There's some stuff that needs to happen in between taking all of the build output and having a working image. And that's where scriptlets happen. And it's kind of a problem, because it's magic, and we don't really know how it works or what it's doing. But we can deal with this. So yeah, the magic is what makes this hard. Like, in theory, the process of building an image, like I'm saying, should just be, all right, we've got all this build output sitting around, cram it into a folder, and you're done. Or maybe you have to do some other stuff. And we know some of that, but we really don't know what goes on. We have this enormous heap of magic scripts that happen. And they do stuff. And because of that, we have problems like composes take a really long time, sometimes it fails. We need root to do this for some reason, even though it's all just data. We're just moving data around. You shouldn't need to be the super user to just make an image. You're just moving files from one place to another. It's just moving bits around. So like, why is it all so hard? why does it take so long? Why does it keep getting harder? Why do we feel like we're fighting with our tools a lot? And kind of the answer is that RPM was not designed to do this. RPM was designed as a way of basically delivering updates and other things. It's a nice little package format, and it's a good way to, you know, there's a bunch of stuff going on in RPM. It's a build system, it's a packaging format, and it's a delivery mechanism for data. But it wasn't really designed to make images. It was designed in an era where you sort of had, like, where the idea of having to build a whole lot of system images was not really something people thought about. You didn't have virtualization, you didn't have containers or anything like that. You had a computer, and you did an install on it, and then you carefully tended that thing for years. So that was not what RPM was designed for. We made it do all of this stuff, but that's not what it was made for, and we're bumping into these limitations a lot. So, thinking about what we're trying to do and that abstract view of what we're doing, if we were going to build it all now, the question, one of the central questions of what I've been working on for the past like year or two is, if we were doing it now, like, what would we build? What would it look like? And the more important part is, how do we do that without just burning everything down and starting over? Because as fun as that sounds, it really, we can't do that. We have an entire enormous ecosystem built above and around RPM, and we've inherited some of its limitations, and we'd like to remove those, but we don't want to topple the entire tower. We don't want to, you know, blow up the engines while the plane is flying. We need to replace them. So this is what we've been concerned with. Project Welder is what we're calling the thing that we've been working on, where Welder kind of stands for, well, it stood for a lot of things. The joke right now is it stands for the Wigham Enterprise Linux Wigham Enterprise Linux Distribution Reloaded. So, you know, good for Ralph. It's sort of a experimental toolkit that we are working on and with to look at how we could import build artifacts, store them efficiently, and make it easier and faster to generate custom images, which is a thing that lots of people want to do, and they have a hard time doing it. Part of this is also we have a part called Composer, which is going to be a cockpit-based UI, an API for browsing content, building up recipes, and composing images from those recipes. It's nice looking. I'm not going to get too deep into that because it's a sort of a different project than the stuff we're talking about here. The stuff I'm talking about today is more about laying foundations for making this more efficient. Because if we tried to run this thing using the tools that we have today for building images, it would fall over very, very quickly. It takes like 10 to 30 minutes to build an image, and then you have to store all of them, and it just wouldn't scale well. So we can get this working at a small scale, but if we want to do this on a much larger scale, we're going to need better ways of building images. So, and a couple of quotes. I have a couple little demos, but I want you to, I like combining these two quotes. Which is, you know, standard Arthur C. Clarke is that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. But as Teller of Penn and Teller has said, sometimes magic is just someone spending way more time on something than anyone else might reasonably expect, which is a thing that has come up a couple of times. So here is, I hope, a demo of. So this is us using the Welder toolkit to build a web server. And build a Docker container that has a web server in it. Now, I'm kind of skipping through it a little bit because I don't need to play the whole deal, but the important part right here is we've got like a recipe, which we'll show. Yeah, so there's a recipe that lists some stuff that it wants to have in it. Oops, yeah, there you go. It's just a few packages. It's not important what's in there.
Could it be increased more, maybe?
It's a video,
so I kind of can't.
Can you go full screen on the video?
I can try. Is that better? This is about the best I can do. But really, the important part here is one little thing. Where are you at? So
that full screen button at the bottom right. Oh, there is one.
Get bigger and biggin. No, much bigger.
That's just bigger enough.
Now. It's not super exciting. Like, text-based demos are not the best thing. But really, what I want to show off here is this: the time it takes to do this. Because we're going to generate an entire. All right, so I'm going to type my password, and it's doing dev solving. It's starting to compose, and in a couple seconds, now the compose should be finished, and it starts doing a Docker import. So at that point, we're done. Like, that was a complete compose of a web server. And the rest is a Docker import, and then it takes a second to start up. It's mostly just I/O bound at this point. And there you go, we enter the image, and boosh. So the problem is it doesn't work. And I'll get to why in a minute. The second demo is similar, except this time it does work. It's this the same sort of thing. We're gonna generate an image, except we're generating a Qcat2 image this time around, and we're booting it in QEMU. And so, I mean, this one takes a little longer, mostly just because we actually need to build a complete, or we need to do formatting and stuff of a disk image. But it's roughly the same thing. I think this one takes about 20 seconds, something like that. The current, a lot of the stuff that we're trying to do for continuous integration, I think the average runtime from kickoff to startup, there you go, it's already booted. So yeah, the usual time I think is about 10 minutes right now, so we're getting to about, yeah, in the range of 30 seconds and less. We haven't tried to optimize this yet. So yeah, here we go. Now it's booted and I can log in. And I'll log in and then you'll see me having, yeah. Oh yeah, there's no netstat.
Oh, but the demo continues, right? This is where you add in.
Oh yeah. Well, yeah. Well, this is where I do a nasty bash hack. yeah, to see whether or not the port is open. It isn't. And then I start the web server, and it starts. So that the point here is that we can build custom images really, really quickly that work like they're supposed to, and then I'm going to go, in this demo I go through and I do some other nonsense about throwing the package that contains netstat just to sort of prove that, yes, we are building custom images at the time you ask, and this isn't like, smoke and mirrors. It's a little bit smoke and mirrors, but everything's smoke and mirrors, right? But there you go. We're creating everything. We built the image. It's doing that. Right now it's doing some disk processing stuff because it's creating a QCAL, and then it'll boot. So the point is, it works, it makes images that work, and they work real quick, which would be super helpful for things like CI and CD.
So do we skip here?
Sorry?
What do we skip here to be fast?
So there's the question, how does it work? So there's a bunch of parts to this whole thing, and mostly what we're skipping is scriptlets. But we're skipping a whole lot of stuff. So one of the things that we're doing is we've got, instead of pulling this all out of RPMs, instead of decompressing all of the RPMs, we've got everything stored in what we call BDCS, a binary data content store, or originally the big damn content store. It's deduplicating binary object storage, it's built on OS tree, it's doing file level deduplication, so we're not storing multiple copies of everything that's in there. And this is super helpful because, like, 99% of the time, two subsequent builds are 99% the same thing. It's a couple of one-line changes or a small patch. And so storing, instead of having individual RPMs for everything, so by storing it in this form, it's equivalent data, but we're using a lot less disk space, and we can pull things out a lot faster because we don't have to decompress the entirety of every package as we go through them. So yeah, as you can see, it's generally around 50% or less of the size, depending on which dimensions you're putting in there, right? For Fedora 26, I just put in every arch, but only the GA release, and it's about half as much disk space. The trial with RHEL, we just did one arch, but we did it over time, and it went down. It's 8 gig instead of 22 gig.
That's compressed RPMs on the left, and uncompressed but deduped on the right.
Correct. Okay.
Are you sure it's uncompressed?
They actually are compressed. Yeah, they're file Zs, so I guess they're gzipped, but it's not. We're not like compressing the entire thing into anything super heavy.
So wait, is that the input or the output?
So the BDCS is where we store we take all of the RPMs, and instead of storing them in a YUM repo, we cram them into the BDCS.
Okay.
And this is partly just to make it so that we have different forms of how this stuff looks on disk, and what we can do with the metadata, which is the next thing, the MDDB, which is actually just part of the It's part of the BCS, but we kind of think of it as a separate object. We need to embed it in there. We just haven't gotten there yet. This is all very like early alpha prototype stuff, but it's really an exercise in thinking about how we do these things. So the metadata database that goes in there, it's RPM compatible metadata. We're just cramming it into a big SQLite database. But we're doing slightly different structure of it so that we can extend it if we feel like it. We could do things like we keep capturing sub-packages, but you could do other stuff. We could have multiple markers for things that are like both docs and binaries, or there's a lot of possibilities that we could open up if we started adding arbitrary data into our data stores. And we can go into that in a little bit, but I want to kind of talk about the scriptlet bits, because there's a lot of interesting stuff we can do with more metadata, but that's sort of some blue sky stuff that I want to get to in a little while. So the other thing is we're using our own depth solver, a modular depth solver, in fact, so that we could extend things. It's a standard three-set-based depth solver thing like libsolve. It's a very well-studied problem. This is some fairly, easy computer science type things. So we have a RPM-compatible depth solver that's not using the RPM code base, so that we can do RPM things, but we could do other things too.
So when you say RPM-compatible, do you mean actually compatible, or just roughly the same thing?
Let's talk about equivalence. Because a lot of times we talk about things being compatible or equal, and we don't do a good job of defining what we mean by that. We're kind of cheating a bit here in that we define whether it's compatible as whether the outputs work. So I don't care whether or not the dependency solving output is identical to RPM or YUM. I care whether or not everything that the user expects is in the output and whether the output works. So
not compatible.
I mean, depends on what you mean by compatible, right? We use the RPM metadata, we get approximately the same results, we get working images, and we do it 100 times faster. So, and also we can extend it. The core of this is generic. It's just a SAT solver. So we could add modules for any other types of things we wanted to solve. In theory, we could do stuff like, we could teach it about, say, cargo crates, and just start pulling in Rust module or Rust crates, and rather than having to manually repackage things, just pull them directly into the BDCS as they are, and then a user can construct their things out of, Red Hat content, but also upstream content, or Fedora content, or whatever they can get their hands on and whatever we know how to do. There's probably some wrinkles to that, but so far there's no technical reason that couldn't work. We just need to get enough. We just need enough metadata to understand how it works, and most of it's already there. And also things like pluggable policies. There's things in modularity land where we're gonna want to have. Sometimes the user will want the newest version of the package if there's multiple providers. Sometimes they'll want whatever is the best or what is recommended by whatever. And so having more types of metadata and more inputs for that allows more flexibility. We wrote it in Haskell. We wrote it in Haskell because there it is. Partly because all of our previous stuff is in Python, and Python carries with it. You have to have your entire runtime environment. And you have dynamic typing, and so you end up with a lot of like non-type errors. So it's harder for us up front, but the type system and things ensure that. Every time we have code that doesn't compile, that's one bug that's not reported. We have to fix it before it goes out in the wild. It's also really heavy into referential transparency and not having side effects. And as I'm saying before, a lot of the problems that we have with RPM as it stands is about side effects and not knowing what's going on with scriptlets. there's a whole lot of really nice stuff about working with Haskell for this sort of thing. It doesn't have to be it, because mostly this is a research and development and experimental thing where a lot of what's going to be born out of this project is not like code, but sort of blueprints for how to do things, or data, or schemas for storing things. So, and you know, plus Facebook's using it, so it's cool now, right? So yeah, it's RPM compatible.
Should go back?
What? Oh yeah.
Is there an Easter egg in the second to last bullet there? We
what?
Might not understand what that means.
What? I mean, if you've ever looked at Haskell, yeah, everyone's like, well, what's a monad? It's just a monad in the category of endofunctors. Like, if you have any background in category theory, it's trivial.
Oh, all right.
Yeah.
Thanks.
No, Haskell is sort of an Haskell's a kind of an obtuse programming language because it was designed sort of for and by computer scientists, but it's finding a lot of the concepts of functional programming languages are finding their way into mainstream programming paradigms, and everyone's like, wow, this stuff is great, and all the Haskell guys are like, yeah, we told you so. So there's a lot of stuff about referentially transparent, so we always know exactly what's happening in the code that allows for really interesting stuff. Like, when we know that there's not going to be a when we know that two pieces of code aren't going to interact because we can see every point in the code and there's no side effects to any of the things where there are hidden interactions, you can do things like automatically parallelizing code. Just tell it to be parallel, and it does. It's pretty cool. It has a lot of really nice stuff. It's not as easy as writing Python, but really important code, I think. It's all right if it's hard to write, if it gets written well and it does what it's supposed to. So yeah, what we're talking about here is RPM compatible, but RPM independent is the goal that we're shooting for, where it does everything it's supposed to do, but without using any of the existing code base, so that we can figure out what part of the larger problem here is that we, as a sort of community and ecosystem, don't know what all our parts are doing. And if we want to improve them, we kind of have to pull them apart and look hard at them and be like, what are we actually using RPM for here? Sometimes it's like, well, it's a pretty convenient data storage format. Well, there are better data storage formats that could be equivalent, and you know, that's fine. But sometimes you have to know what all the pieces are to actually be able to know whether or not it's equivalent. So even just the exercise of trying to make equivalent software, it doesn't have to be successful. It still allows us to understand what's going on and improve things because we've identified how all the pieces fit together. So there's still value in that. So, scriptlet reform. One of the reasons this is important is when you look at all of the scriptlets, when you do a compose normally, we end up with a list of like 300 packages to 1500 packages, depending what kind of system you're building. And the reason that what we do is fast is that we're skipping the scriptlets. Because normally you have to do install package or do a prescript, install payload of package one, fsync, do postscript, fsync, and so on and so forth. It's very slow, and a lot of times there's a lot of wasted effort. Oh, sorry.
You forget the pre-trans and the post-trans.
Yes, there's pre-trans, fsync, pre, fsync, install payload, fsync, then post, and then fsync, and then maybe another post, and then, yeah, there's a lot going on there that doesn't need to be happening. Because at the time that we start the transaction, other than that wrinkle of scriptlets, we know exactly what files are going to be in that file system. And then we need to run some scripts. And because we don't know whether or not any of those scripts requires anything that's in the previous packages, we have no choice but to run them in order. We cannot reason about anything that's going on there. Partly because we like RPM doesn't give us any way to express it. And we can't introspect on it. Like, what does that do? I found six I found six different ways that scriptlets create empty files, because I went through and read literally every scriptlet in RHEL 7, because sometimes magic is spending more time on something than anyone would reasonably find useful. So I went through and read literally every scriptlet in all of RHEL.
Why?
Yeah, exactly. Why?
Why would you even do that?
It's
because somebody's makefile did that. And
right, exactly. Because scriptlets are written by individual contributors, often little silos, and they don't know, you know, and we have some guidelines, but there are no hard and fast rules about how things should get done, nor are there tools for the common tasks. nor have we really identified what the common tasks are. We're just sort of like, well, here's a hook, best of luck. And so we have this heap of scripts that's sort of accumulated over the past 15 years that are maintained by disinterested people who don't necessarily know anything about shell. The Java package scriptlets are a thing of horrific Lovecraftian beauty. But anyway, so ignoring all that. Oh, and also there's the fact that there's like three separate Turing complete languages in there, because you have shell and Lua, and also the templating language itself is Turing complete. So
in your review of all those scriptlets, did you find like meaningful scriptlet functionality that like did something that you need to take into account?
I did. I found six. 99% of them are doing one of these six things. Mostly what happens here is one of these six things. There is some stuff that's totally insane where it's like, oh, let's load a kernel module because I might want to use it, or I'm going to, despite whatever the user might want, I'm going to forcibly turn on this service. Or there's a lot of like, there's some questionable stuff that doesn't need to have them, but 99% of it is doing one of these six things, and we do have tools to handle all of these. We have, you know, there's like systemd now has stuff to handle this. A lot of them, creating users and groups, we have sysusers.d. I would say we could just use that, but there's sometimes their file formats might be a little too simple. There's the whole problem with sysusers.d. If you try and tell it to make a user with a zero, like say 0 day as a username.
Oh, here we go.
You end up with a root user.
Yeah.
Sometimes file formats can be a little too simple, and this is why types are a good thing. You go back to Haskell for a second, because if you know you're expecting a string, you don't care that it starts with a zero. So you might want to be a little more. So part of what I'm sort of proposing here, and I haven't really, I'm still working on the schema and all that. What I'm proposing for a first step towards improving the entire ecosystem and allowing more of what we're doing to happen is that we identify all of the places where these tasks are happening, create standard tools that handle those, and convert scriptlets to use those tools. So to give you an example, the users and groups one is the easy one. I've got a nice long JSON, or I've got a schema here that basically says everything you can do when you're creating a user. This encapsulates all the stuff that happens. And it's not super complicated, it's long, but it's just like, okay, yeah, your GID is gonna be an integer. So this is a schema that describes everything you can do with a user. And so then what a maintainer would do, instead of doing I've seen like six different ways that users get created in scriptlets also. Instead, you would just do that. And in fact, what you would do is wrap it in that. So what you have here is, it's equivalent to what they had before, to whatever user add and all of that line is, except the logic of whether or not to add the user and when to add the user would be handled by the interpreter. Now, the fact that we're using an interpreter here is that has two purposes. One is that, you know, we have some tool, a standard tool that handles it. The other is that external tools can examine the headers of the RPM, and when they see that that's the interpreter, they know that the content is going to be that. And so we've moved from opaque code to nice, introspectable data.
That does have to be pre, not post.
Does it?
Yes. Because otherwise, the RPM, when it installs, the files have to be right.
It'll train.
I guess so. Well, see, there's another, like, because I think you can just lay, when it lays down the files, I think RPM stores them. RPM does store them as strings, so yeah, RPM wants there to be the file, and then it looks like the UID from there. This would have to be pre.
One thing I would note at this point, that this is not going against RPM philosophy at all.
Yeah.
RPM, no, I don't think so.
Essentially, it's a macro processor by itself.
Yeah.
That's just use of that.
Yeah, exactly. This is a good example of a way that we can make changes to our ecosystem that allow us to do some really interesting stuff without breaking it all down. With this sort of thing in place, we sort of fake it in the demo that I showed, the second demo. We sort of faked it. We went through and looked through all of them and found every time something was created in the user, and we just have a hack that creates every possible user before we build when we build the image. But with things like this, we know what's, we can examine the payload of what we're trying to install, and we can know whether or not we need to create users, or we can like do it later. We can reason about when and why to do certain tasks. For instance, going back a bit, like the scriptlet tasks, some things like registries, caches, and things like that, you don't need to do those until, some of them you don't need to do until first boot. So if you're pressed for time, like if you want a dash dash turbo switch, yeah, just skip all of the registries until first boot.
And actually, nothing of type 4 should really ever exist in a spec file. Trying to get to the point where it isn't.
Right.
RPM file triggers should conceivably take care of everything. And almost all of that is already done, except for LD config, because glibc is resistant to change.
But there's still the problem with knowing that that's what's going on in a postscript. You still, like, we still can't, we can't just assume that every file trigger is a cache or a cache catalog or registry. Some things are required, and some things, if you don't run it, your stuff's not going to work, and some things, yeah. So having a way to express that sort of metadata is super useful.
I'm just saying that the package itself should care.
Right. Well, that's the long-term goal, is to get this stuff sort of back into data, where you declare what you want to happen, and the tools figure out what to do, rather than it being code that we just have to run, and we have to run it as root because we don't know whether or not it runs root, and then we have to run it immediately because we don't know whether or not we can do it later. And so the one of the major themes about making this stuff faster and more predictable and less hard is any place where we can take complexity and declarative code and turn it, or complexity and code and turn it into nice data is a really good idea. We already have tools that handle most of this stuff, but it's just having a standardized sort of interface. And we can have like a nice little RPM scriptlet that, or an RPM macro that would just be like, percent user whatever, and you give it the necessary stuff, and then we expand that to whatever. I still want to see the interpreter line in there so that external tools can identify what's happening.
So on that, what happens if you need to do two of six things?
You can have multiple scripts.
Yeah, you can have multiple.
You can have multiple scripts. You just separate them into multiple. You can have multiple pre and multiple post, and it just runs them in order.
Yes.
Yep.
And the other part is that this allows us to actually do security auditing, automated security auditing, before the change comes into production.
Exactly. And another thing that this allows is that, like, in theory, you could confine these things. Anything that has that interpreter should not be reading or writing to any file other than etsy shadow, etsy group, and etsy password. And if it tries to do any of that, no, you go away. So, like, it's a nice little security thing. I have ideas, or I have schemas written up for some of the other tasks listed here, but I kind of ran out of time with my slides, sorry. So that's the sort of general idea, that sort of the background and the big ideas, but also this one very specific little slice that we'd like to get moving on to enable us to make forward progress. That's sort of my pitch and some background. Are there any questions? Go for it.
So what you envision with this is you are hoping to get to a model or a universe where most of the RPMs you care about, your new dev solver or installer can actually look at them and say, aha, all of these scriptlets are run using interpreters I'm familiar with, and I know that I can safely batch the activities that they're doing until the end.
Yep, exactly. And there's other nice things about it. Like, you can, if we start marking, the ones that are turning off services on and off, what if we were having scriptlet, or if we have RPM spec files declaring what services are in there? And then you can look at a set of packages and say, and like know exactly what services are going to be in the resulting image and whether they'll be on or off by default. And then you could say, override that as a user. Letting it be more of scriptlet or more data oriented allows us to reason about what's happening rather than just having to dump it all in the box.
Yeah. You should only need to have the list of the services, because the presets already handle which ones will be on and off, and if they're doing otherwise in the RPM, they are breaking rules.
It's surprising how much that happens.
Well, yeah, I mean, actually, just the audit, just the work you did to collect that data, it's actually terribly useful, because we're trying to get, in the packaging guideline, there's one way to create users. That's the one you should be using.
Yeah.
You should be, we'd hate to have anybody ever have to cut and paste code, we'd rather it be automatic, but...
Yeah.
The data editing was about Rails.
What's that?
You edited the Rails spec files, right? The Rails spec files, not the Fedora.
RETL.
Yeah.
Not Fedora.
I went through a lot of Fedora, and I don't recall whether or not it was the same situation. I mean, you know, there's a lot more, so it gets a lot weirder
with
the side edges. But no, I was in RHEL, I was still finding things like non-standard, like programs I didn't even know existed being used to create users, and I'd like look up what this program did, and I was like, oh, you're creating a user, that's new.
Okay. Those technically should be considered bugs.
They
maybe
should.
Not in RHEL, but in Fedora, yes. It's
sure.
Thing that
but even if, we standardized on a standard scriptlet that people should be using,
right.
It would still be a scriptlet. It would
That's
still be
true.
Opaque code, and we'd have to go through and change all of them later.
Except that you could do that in an automated fashion, whereas if they followed the pattern, whereas if it was random stuff, then you could just...
The other thing that I've started doing is written a shell parser that sort of simulates shell to look at scriptlets and figure out what they're doing. So it can kind of convert from existing scriptlets to this format, to data formats. It's not complete yet because parsing shell is horrible, but it worked enough that we got a complete list of all of the places that users were being created.
Okay.
And we could probably extend it to other stuff. I imagine that will be more like, depending on how easily we can convince people to convert scriptlets, it might be the case that we want to have something like that as a sort of like the Python 2-3 tool to be like, run this against your scriptlet and it'll tell you what you probably should be doing, but it'll also tell you if there's stuff that it doesn't understand that you need to deal with yourself. Or we can just say everybody has to reconvert all their stuff now. But first we need to define the actual tools and all of that. And the tools are in progress but not finished, and the schemas are in progress but not finished, so that's, you know, a ways off. Yes, 80%.
I'm writing this answer down.
Nice. I'd say like if it was my only priority, we could probably have something like that. We're just having the tools.
Something, yeah, so that it actually works and we can give it to packages and say, can you put this in your spec?
Well, so do you mean the technical side of it or the political / policy side of it? Because I can't predict when this would be
people right now.
What's
when
that?
The problem solved. when is the rough timeline when you can put it in the first package in Fedora?
When do we start doing, or when do we cut over for, I guess, when do we open up for, what are we at, F28, 29, where are we even? What month is this?
27 recently branched for all highest 28.
Okay, we just started 28. So we could, I mean, definitely 29, we could probably start doing it in a, we could probably have tools ready for at least one of the, I mean, for at least users in the next, month, easy. So, next couple of weeks.
Are the interpreters, are you suggesting those be written in Haskell as well?
They should probably be written in something that compiles to native binaries.
Right.
I would write them in Haskell just to get my Haskell muscles up, but...
Then did the modularity people care that you now put Haskell in the minimal set of things you need to get in?
It's a build root for Terminal.
Yeah.
They sort of care.
For self-hosting?
No. Nobody cares
about
build root.
Yeah. The build root for minimal hosting platform is a lot bigger than minimal hosting platform.
Right, but you're trying to shrink it. But if you stick Haskell in there as a hard dependency, then...
But if you start talking about the larger picture of what we're actually trying to accomplish, which is to say making it so that you can, and a point that I didn't make really well here is that we're constructing images totally differently than we have in the past, and that we're constructing them using none of the tools that are inside it. We're constructing them completely from the outside. Which means, like, that's a pretty major shift in thinking. And so things like, well, what's in the build root? It's like, I don't care what's in the build root because the build root is a totally different system.
Maybe.
Most people probably already have Pandoc in there anyway.
Yeah, right. And Pandoc's Haskell, so yeah.
But somebody cares. Somebody else might care, is the thing. There are people trying to figure out the minimal set of self-hosting, which includes being able to build itself and install itself.
Right.
Which, I mean, there's another effort just down the hall that is worried about things like adding Haskell to that minimal set. That's the only reason I mentioned it. So.
Well, Haskell's more important than Rust right now. Anyway.
Well,
yeah.
Sure. I mean,
yep.
the Haskell has dynamic linking, doesn't it? I mean, so it wins as far as
I would suggest not blocking on the decision about whether or not.
Oh, no, of course not.
Yeah, I mean, I could write these things in Python, but I would not be proud of them, and I would not want people to use them. And I wouldn't want to carry that, because then you have the problem of it being in the pre-scripts for things, and it's
right.
Yeah. So there's a little bit of finesse to be done there.
Well,
so, yeah, Brendan.
Is there a reason why you went from one kind of scriptlet to another kind of scriptlet instead of extending the RPM syntax?
Because you didn't have to.
I mean, we can extend the RPM. We could add a macro that's percent %user, you know, and just do that, and it would expand out to the part with the
right.
With the interpreter. So like behind the scenes, that's what it would be, but the user doesn't need to, or the maintainer doesn't need to handle that. And that would be my goal. I just kind of ran out of time for that in the slides. Adding a set of macros that would do this for the maintainers.
That's probably where we will go eventually.
Yeah. Yep.
I mean, it's usability part.
Yeah, exactly. But as long as the macro expands to something that has a well-known thing in the header, and we know what the data inside is going to look like, then you unlock all sorts of new tricks.
Huh. So you could actually do the macro now.
Yep.
Yes. Then it could expand to what we use now.
Yes.
It could.
And
yeah.
Then
and then we
behind
the
scenes,
can,
it expands to what something else later.
Yep. Yes. And then, or it could expand to two things, one of which just created a new header that we use.
Yep.
Yeah. There's a lot of ways to do it.
So one of the things for the interpreter is the assumption that you're never going to upgrade the interpreters.
That you're never going to what?
So your interpreter is going to say, like, user bin, welder, like, add user, right?
Right.
If you don't put, like, a version in the command name, then you can never upgrade, like, the data that's inside it, right? Because anything that's inspecting that doesn't know what version of the command it's inspecting.
I mean, that's fair. Especially user accounts, I'm not as worried about that before,
right.
Because like user accounts haven't really changed their schema in 40 years, but no, for the other stuff, that's a fair point.
We will already have this common Fedora with the SSSD doing the local account storage. And
there's always stuff that can change,
yeah,
but
one constant.
At worst, stick a version in there somewhere. And,
yeah, it's probably a good idea.
I mean, if you're hiding it behind macros, who cares? People don't have to see.
Yeah, that's the sort of thing that we could probably hash out sometime during the rest of this week, is that sort of thing. Because this was just sort of like the general idea is, hey, more data, less code.
Did you mention this talk?
Oh, yeah, and... Do you want to plug your talk, or do you want me to plug? Because I don't actually...
Well, I plugged it this morning, but similar things. We've got a bunch of stuff that... Yeah, there are a bunch of scriptlets out there that do things like set up system-specific information about a service when it's installed, which is really bad when trying to generate something like a container image or a virtual gold master. So a while back, I worked up some packaging guidelines that I wanted to plug about how we can take those things and make them using systemd to. To solve them on the first start of a service rather than at installation time.
Right.
So they can also be wiped at any time to reset essentially the system to factory defaults.
And that's scriptlet task number 6.
Right. So that's yes, exactly. So that's a talk I plan to give on Thursday morning at 11:30.
Right. Anything that's generating like a unique ID or an encryption key or things like that. Yeah, that needs to get moved.
It's even the other problem is that the scriptlets are run using an SLinux specific context.
Yeah.
So some of the operations will be denied under that context if it's launching certain things as a part of the upgrade
right.
script.
Right. So
but
yeah, having a separate interpreter means you could do an SLinux transition or transition into a more confined domain.
Right.
Yeah.
Like
the
right
mechanism
now,
I developed
right
also could be transitioned.
For example, we can use system control because that's just a DBus code, so we can confine what system control under RPM scriptlet can do in that context using the DBus code or systemd. But if it's something like you did with install, you showed it on the previous slide with install, that's something that we just can deny completely in the RPM scriptlet or RPM install context.
Yeah, I mean, really, this should just be a line that declares I want this file to exist in the empty and have this mode.
And that's a different thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
This subject, just real quick, right now RPM OSG today, when you're doing composes, not yet when you're doing composes on the server side, but on the client side, we actually run, we have basically have like an 80% re-implementation of Lube RPM, and we run the scripts in bubble wrap. So like right now, every RPM scriptlet, like, so you know, my workstation, I have a couple packages later, but those scripts don't have access to my home directory. Like, they just can't see it. We don't, and actually we disable system CTL, because like part of the whole idea is to do an offline update, so rather than change your current root file system and potentially restart some services, but not much for doing it. So like, yeah, I think we'll have to make try and make sure some of the efforts here align with kind of what we're doing our RPM OSG too, because we have quite a bit of this.
And I will say that some of this stuff, like mostly the updating registries and caches, there's a lot of stuff that does that, and not all of it is designed to be able to operate from outside, or is not, I don't know if all of it's Arch neutral, or, and I know not all of it is designed to operate from outside a system. A lot of it is. As far as I can tell, any of the tasks except number 4 can be done from the outside of the system pretty easily with existing tools. A lot of the registry cache type stuff can, but isn't currently, but we could shift it, and some of it just isn't, and that's going to be the tricky part.
Part 6 is potentially ARC specific and should be done within the system.
Right. Anything that's system specific should not happen until first boot, like, obviously.
Yeah, that is exactly my talk.
Yes. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
So, assuming we can do, you've done 1, kind of.
Yeah.
System dependent is 2.
Yep.
3 should be trivial.
3 is basically temp files dot d and
right,
system
right.
Temp files.
Right. 6 seems to install.
Yep.
So how big of a problem at 4 and 5?
So 5 is arguably actually more like you can make an argument that some of the stuff that's 1 and 5, like creating users and groups and messing with the firewall configuration, you're really just sort of modifying a system configuration file. So like you could probably merge these together. Conceptually, it's easier to think of it that way.
Making those declarative would be a big step forward.
But yeah, exactly. And the existing tools that fall under the bucket 5 for system configuration, I think, can be used from the outside right now. So probably we can figure that out. But it's, yeah, that fifth one is sort of a miscellaneous bucket at the moment, so a little more research might be needed, but so far it hasn't yielded anything scary. 4, there's a lot of stuff that's like, okay, and then you have to run, you know, whatever code inside the thing, and everyone's just like, yeah, sure, that's totally cool. Run whatever binary you want as root every time I update this package. That's great to me. That's not my favorite, and a lot of those things are really old, things like term info files being compiled. Like, I don't know if the term info guys were like, someday people are going to want to create Docker images. Like, no, they didn't think of that. So, like, there's gonna come a point where we're going to hit some necessary tool that needs to build something that's not technically Arch specific, but it doesn't know how to build from the outside, and we're going to have to, like, think about modifying the tool to do it that way, because I really, really believe that for the long-term health of like how we construct images, doing them from the outside is the right way to do it. It's the only way that makes any sort of sense
to
me.
And if this is obvious to everyone else, you know, forgive me. Do you envision a day where the packaging guidelines forbid arbitrary bash scripting?
Oh, absolutely.
That
would be my first decree.
Talk about that.
I found that most of the time when you find it, it's things you really wish shouldn't be in there. I'm going to modify your existing configuration file for this thing.
Yeah, there's a lot of like random set, and I definitely found like places where people do it wrong. Like I found a whole lot of bugs in scriptlets where it's like, oh, you got the sense of this test inverted, so that will never happen. Cool. Well, okay.
Yeah.
And in that sense, the migration from init to systemd is illustrative, right? Because you have these examples of all sorts of weirdly arbitrary ways of doing start stop,
right,
restart,
exactly.
Except
been
that
replaced
there's
by a largely declared.
Yeah, there's only, it's just a couple of macros, and there's only 2
right.
different patterns you're ever supposed to
and
use.
It works
yep.
tons
so,
better.
Yeah,
yep.
We're all better off.
Exactly.
And a lot of people are still angry about it.
As long as you can.
So,
as long as you can hand people, like, all right, like, you can't do whatever you want, but all of the stuff that you want to do, here's a, you know, here's an individual tool for each of them. Like, people don't seem, well, no, there are plenty of people who are real mad about that, but they're the sort of people who are mad about anything when it's different.
That's so. The 20% you haven't finished yet.
Well, yes.
I mean, so
we are over time, but I'm willing to talk about this for hours. But I'm going to say after 5 more minutes, you have to buy me a beer if you want to keep talking about it.
All right, I'll buy you beers.
Hell yeah.
You use OS3 as an intermediate format, but the things you're generating are like regular images at this point.
We can generate OS3 output. It's not RPM OS3 because we're not generating an RPM database inside the output. We could do that, and like I've kind of come to the conclusion that we might have to synthesize an RPM database in our output, and Colin's had some suggestions and tricks around that, but I really don't want to. Because in theory, if you've got a system where you can almost instantaneously, like the reason it takes 6 seconds is because we haven't optimized it yet. It's almost instantaneous. We're IO bound essentially in creating images. So if you wanted to update an image, like why are we building an RPM database inside it afterward? Why don't you just generate a different image that has the stuff you wanted in it? That would be faster and easier.
That covers a lot of use cases.
Exactly.
Like,
wait, having the RPM database or generating a new image?
Generating the new image.
Well, the other thing about doing it like that is that, yeah, it's almost instantaneous. We don't have to save them to disk. Like, we can just write them on the fly as soon as you request them. Also, like, if we're doing it so that the recipes are all deterministic, like, if we know, okay, you did it on this day, we know you had this metadata and this recipe, therefore, we already know what the output is. If somebody already did that and we cached it, like, we can just hand it to you again. Like, making this a little more messy.
We need this in production. All this information, I mean, in production. The metadata about what's in the system, how the things that are on the image that is being run different from what was installed originally. So if the config files are changed and something like that, because the whole source report tool that we use in Red Hat support depends on that.
Yeah,
so we need to solve this case, like Adam said.
Yeah, there are definitely, this is another one of those cases where we have to look at the things that RPM does provide for us. And yeah, having a manifest that inside the image that has the provenance and exact signatures of all of the files that were provided by the vendor is like a really good thing. And yeah, we should absolutely do that in some form.
Inspectable also inside the run image.
Yep. No, that's definitely something that we need to do. We just haven't figured out how we're going to do it. And I'm not convinced the RPM database is the best or only way to do it.
Which RPM database? They're changing it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, the fact that if you want to install a package, like especially if you're installing a module, you need like an XML parser, a YAML parser, a SQLite database, a DB4, I'm missing at least two other types of data formats. Oh, RPM headers. Like, there's just so much that happens when it could just really be like, we have one database and one data format, and you're good. We'll get there eventually, but we're not going to worry about doing that all at once, because we can't just burn it down. Sorry, Rim.
Question. The syntax that you had on the previous screen, demoing, that, and then going back to the next screen you were just on. So that syntax looks a whole lot like the Ansible definitions, and we're working on the Ansible variables.
Well,
and we're working on the system roles using Ansible to define like a consistent way to configure all of those subsystems.
Mm-hmm.
We've already got a lot of modules that already add, remove users, and basically configure the system. And so we're addressing a lot of the items under number 5 for like SE Linux and firewall, things like that. Is that useful at all as far as already having something that we're using to configure live systems and leveraging that same work to integrate in here? We just need to change the output of what it's writing to.
I'm pretty sure their stuff is YAML, so we could, I mean, there's a little bit of wiggle room, but you can kind of convert this back and forth. This is TOML, which is basically just JSON with comments that looks more like an INI file, but it's exactly JSON, like you can convert it back and forth to JSON. But you can also put comments in it, so it's better than JSON, yay. So the data formats are a good idea, but we can just translate back and forth between those things, and that's one of the things that, you know, computers are great at. The tricky part is that the way that Ansible stuff wants to actually make the modifications happen is essentially you, as far as I've seen, you have like a Python module that then wants to run code inside the target system,
right.
Yeah. Which doesn't really work with our model. And I've talked to the Ansible folks a little bit about like trying to make their tools so they can operate from the outside or the inside, or thinking about that, thinking about doing it that way, but that's not really what they're thinking about. But having common data formats for the two things, and if we ended up building a tool that does the same thing, but it could do it from the outside of the system instead of from the inside, that wouldn't be bad for them either. So I think there's definitely some back and forth to be done there. But it's not like that's immediately going to solve the problem for us, unfortunately. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
It does. I'm going to harass you with that question more later.
Feel free. I am kind of hard line on the fact that we need to be building images from the outside is the same way of doing it, because it's the only way to make it predictable. Like running arbitrary code inside a system, you don't really know what happens at that point. It's all bets are off. So don't do that. Also, like the other thing that you should know about the demo is that it all ran as a user. Like we didn't need to be root to do any of that, which is kind of nice for security of builders and things like that. And that's what happens when you make all of your process about transforming data instead of taking code that you're not sure what it's doing and running it and hoping for the best.
Well, still, the demo was run as sudo.
Yeah, only because I had to talk to the Docker daemon. But yeah, there's really nothing in that. Like at that point is when it actually sudos. And I needed it to like pause there so that I could look at the thing. But yeah, the actual generating an image does not need to be root. As long as you're not generating a QCAM, you need root for that because you need to be able to do partitioning and loopback mounting. So, but that's just data. We can fix that. We've just been lazy about it. We'll get there. But yeah, this is part of a really long thing in my head to sort of rework how stuff gets built in general. And this is like the first tiny little slice towards redoing that entire big build loop that I was talking about earlier. And most of what we need to do is figure out how to make things not run, not be using opaque code when it could be data that we could think about better, if that makes some sense. So it is now 6:12. Is there any last questions, or is it time for escaping and food and beer? All right. Thanks very much. I really appreciate